Okay, first class, talking in general about what you learn in mechanical systems design. It's a project-driven class. It'll cover a number of topics. Early on, we'll talk about mechanism classification and mobility analysis. This is the condition under which a single input, or say two input, have the effect of determining motion upon the mechanism. We'll study primarily two-dimensional planar mechanisms. We'll look at position, velocity, acceleration, limit position of links of interest, time ratios, a concept first introduced in machine tools like shapers, and then transmission angle calculation is a performance indicator of how a motion can be transmitted through a mechanism without the possibility of jamming links. We'll learn the basics of synthesizing linkages as opposed to analysis. Synthesis is a matter of sizing the links, shapes of links that'll be the CAM problem, design problem, but in general, link length, fixed angles that'll make linkage satisfy closely an imposed task. We'll learn about motors, electric motors, another type, and actuators, engines as well. We'll look at force analysis in machines and mechanisms, the very basics of force analysis. We'll learn about statics and dynamics dynamic balancing. learn about flywheels, CAM mechanism, CAM foul mechanisms. Learn about type of foul motion, how can generate the profile of this CAM to satisfy an imposed foul motion. We'll learn about gears, primarily involved gears, velocity ratio calculation, how involved keys can be generated. And additional chapters, we're not going to cover them, but I have notes prepared and available on engine reciprocating engine and compressor dynamics, balancing problems, mainly vibrations of single degree of freedom, free force vibration, critical speed of shafts, sensors, and design project. It will be a semester-long project with a midterm report. And the final report. Okay, there will be a number of animations used to substantiate what is discussed in class. And you will be learning how to use working model. I'm going to play working model simulations for you to better understand the material. I also have a, and this is expanding a collection of mechanism photographs of mechanisms. I'll make available to you. I have selected from an online source this rear axle of a truck, which I'm assuming it to be quintessential, that is, has elements of actuators, linkages, cams, gear reducers in one unit. So again, it's a rear axle of a medium truck, and there is a bevel gear reducer with the differential. There is another planetary gear reducer, similar to some extent to the differential of axle differential, but acting as a 2-to-1 gear reducer, torque increaser by the same amount, 2-to-1. And then we have an actuators. Actually, there are two of them, membrane actuators. There is a spring inside of each, and compressed air forces that spring in compression and disengages the brakes. If you lose air, or if apply the brakes, air is released, and the spring forces the each of these two shafts via a linkage. So it will be the case of a slider rocker mechanism. So it forces the two shafts in rotation. This is called S-cam. And what it does, it spreads the shoes and provides the friction torque to slow the truck or hold it in park mode. This being the, and everybody realized this is a section view, dissected view. The company logo, it's here, it's a Renault French brand or car maker. Okay, so I mentioned S-cams or cams in general. There are warm wheel reducers part of this link, which serve as slack adjuster. Some can be manually adjusted, some are automatically adjusted. So this is the case of a, the image here shows a automatic slack adjuster. So we have the worm in the wheel gear pair that's interposed between the lever itself and the S-cam shaft, and then through repeated actuation of the of this lever by the membrane actuator, there is so the rotation of the worm is due to this the effect of a rack that engages a pinion at the end of the worm. Manual adjustment is possible, but it also happens automatically. So if the travel of the angular displacement of the S-cam shaft is too big, then there will be some, you can see a slack here that is, at some point it will be closed, and there will be a slight rotation of the shaft, and the angle, relative angle between the lever and the S-cam shaft, it's is adjusted to compensate for the slow wear of the friction pads. Okay, so basic concepts, definitions, mechanisms are assemblies of resistant bodies connected by joints that serve to transmit transform motion. So motion is a first concern. We don't investigate forces and torques at this moment. Machines, though, are same assemblies of bodies that transform the force of nature to accomplish certain determinate motion. And we care about forces and torques and how they, the interaction between bodies occurs under the effect of these forces. I'm writing here that there's no clear-cut divide between machines and mechanisms, and I'm giving the example of steering mechanism, steering system of an automobile, and has a mechanical function, correlate the turning of the front wheels, usually, although you can have rear wheel steer certain way. They don't stay parallel as you they run the car through a turn. So yeah, they can be considered a function generator, it's called. But there are significant forces to be accounted for, as well as they qualify as machines because they're most of the steering nowadays are hydraulic or electrically assisted. Mechatronics, a combination of mechanics and electronics, as well as computer programming, telecommunications, control, so remote control. That's why telecommunications combine. All right, multi-body system is a concept from simulation of bodies interacting, and working model 2D, by the way, is a motion, is a multi-body simulation software. So simulation is with respect to dynamic behavior, dynamic response, such as studying the stability of an automobile, the effect of running it over a bump or doing a lane change maneuver, which of course requires proper modeling of the wheel-tire interaction, and so forth. All right, machinery, broad term used to define assemblies of machines and mechanism usually driven by an engine or a motor, or could be multiple of them. So agricultural machinery, think of the a planter of some sort that is driven from the part takeoff of the tractor, has all sorts of moving parts, with at least one input. You know, from other classes, kinematic study is motion independent of bodies, independent forces that produce motion. And then kinetics, motion of bodies, also particles, but we care less about motion of particles in this class, under the influence of forces. It's for the student, the mechanical engineering student, is very important to be familiar with any of these machines and mechanisms, because you can adapt existing ones to new projects by scaling or slight alteration of the dimensions. And if you're limited in your knowledge of available mechanisms, then you're limited in possible options for the solution to the design problem that you're facing. Terminology. Mechanism consists of links, at least two. They are connected using joints called kinematic pairs. Again, in this class, we'll study primarily planar or two-dimensional mechanisms. That is, all links move in the same plane or in parallel planes. And links can have various shapes, and they can be connected with joints to one or more adjacent links. So you see here a radial engine, five-cylinder engine, and there is a master connecting rod, and then there are secondary connecting rod. So each of the secondary connecting rods is connected by pin joints to adjacent links. One, it's the piston, and the other is the master connecting rod. So we called each of these secondary connecting rod binary links. The master connecting rod has connects by pin joints to, or the number of pin joints of the master connecting rod. There is 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So this is a polynary of 15-ary, whatever that will be, the name. Kinematic link. Kinematic pairs, we mentioned pin joints so far. Pistons move inside cylinders. That's actually correctly is a cylindrical joint, although through their limiting of motion could be assumed prismatic joints. But in essence, the kinematic pairs provide constrained motion between the two bodies that they join. And they are classified based on the connectivity or number of degrees of freedom they allow between two links. The other classification is based on the type of contact that happens between the half joints. So if it's surface contact, like we have it in case of a pin joint or cylindrical joint or a prismatic joint, that's a lower pair. And we can have line or point contact, higher pair. And then joints could be closed. So there's conjugate shape, or open contact is unilateral and it's maintained by gravity, the action of springs and so forth. When we sketch mechanisms, same as electrical engineers use lines to show wires and then symbols for resistors and capacitors and diodes and so forth, we're going to use symbols. For example, this is a binary link and it's skeleton representation. This is a ternary link and its representation. Okay, so circuit diagrams in electrical engineering will be our skeleton diagram, sometimes called kinematic diagrams. And the type of possible joints that you can see in the study of mechanisms would be revolute turning or hinge, also called pin joint, not listed here, symbol R. They are 1 degree of freedom. So by simply specifying the angle between the two links that are joined by the pin joint, you can tell the configuration of the joint. Okay, symbols in 2D, two-dimensional view. If it's three-dimensional view, like the case of robotic arms, we use this symbol. Prismatic joints, they allow just 1 degree of freedom, that is sliding. So if I mark a line on, say, the guide, and then take this surface of the slide as a reference, if I tell the, if I know the distance between that reference line and the surface of the slide, and I can tell the configuration of the joint. So again, 1 degree of freedom, prismatic, translating, sliding, symbol P from prismatic or P from translation. These are both lower pair joints. And then another 1 degree of freedom joint would be rolling without slip. So an idealization. There's always the possibility of slip. Think of a wheel running on a curved surface, curved road. Although you can have gear teeth on both, and or some serration of some sort. But 100%. Or zero slip is could be considered idealization. Why is 1 degree of freedom? Because if I do, say, a full turn of this roller, then I can tell how much, say, it goes in this direction, it will roll to the left, and I can tell, not just for a full turn, but any angular measure of the rotation, I can tell where the roller would be. If we have slip, though, however the case was slip, then I can rotate and slide while maintaining contact between the two surfaces in any combination. So that's why 2 degree of freedom. And I need to specify the angle of rotation and then amount of slide using curvilinear coordinate, say, for the sliding displacement. So again, these are 2 degrees of freedom. Now you look at the shape, so it moves in both Z and Y direction, but the Z and Y and Z displacements are correlated due to the shape of the conjugate surface on which the rolling happens. Particular cases of the rolling with slip type of joints are the pin in a slot joints. And working model has them. It could be straight or curvilinear. and you can have the pin able to slide as well as rotate about its own axis, that is the x-axis. This is the pin in a slot on a rectilinear slot. Okay, so again, these are 2 degrees of freedom. These are higher pairs because the contact is line contact. Same as here, also higher contact or higher pair joint point or rather line contact. And then we have a planar joint. If we study planar or 2D mechanisms, this will be the full motion permitted. So translation about X, translation about Y, and rotation about Z. Those are the 3 degrees of freedom known in two dimensions. There's a lower pair, surface contact. And this is bilateral as well as this one. These are unilateral joints. That is, they can be separated. The half joints or the two bodies connected, they can be separated. Say they're holding contact by the effect of gravity. Okay. Further symbols and kinematic pairs, cylindrical joint. We can slide the cylinder about the guide in the x direction, and we can also rotate about the x-axis. So that's why 2 degrees of freedom, your independent degrees of freedom. However, the helical joint, the screw and nut pair, it's 1 degree of freedom because there is a relationship between the amount of displacement of x and rotation about x. And that's given usually screw or helical joints, they have constant pitch. So if we know the pitch for one turn, it advances relative displacement between the nut and the screw is equal to one pitch. Ball joints, spherical joints, ball and socket joints, common in suspensions of and steering of automobiles and other type of actuations. And here I have, it's a lower pair, I have surface contact, and I can perform rotation by holding the socket fixed. I can take the ball and rotate about X, rotate about Y, as well as rotate about Z axis. Easier to consider is the case where the stem of the ball is in line with the Z axis. Okay, so 3 degrees of freedom. This is a actually all these are spatial kinematic pairs because motion is beyond the motion capable is beyond the two translation and one rotation perpendicular to the two translations. Ball and socket joint, if we place a pin and have a slot as shown, then I can no longer rotate the ball with its stem relative to the socket. And I could transmit torque. This is a symbol of the universal joints or constant velocity joints that you see in automobiles and in trucks. Front wheel drive vehicles have one of these, actually pairs of these on for each wheel, and then the drive shaft taking the power from the outside output of transmission to the rear axle in trucks. Although there we use what are called cardan or universal joint. Ball in a cylinder with a pin. I said at some point that you see them on the inside. It is right out as it comes out of the transmission for a front wheel drive car. You have the possibility, in addition to transmitting torque about the Z axis, I can also have displacement about the z-axis. You can see the difference between these two. And this would be the equivalent of the tripod joint inside of each of the two half shafts on a front-wheel drive car. Ball in a cylinder with a narrow slot, ball in a cylinder with a wide slot. If the slot is narrow, I can slide only about this x-axis. I can rotate about the z-axis. So let's see, what are the allowable degrees of freedom? I can rotate about z, I can slide about x, and I can rotate about y. 3 degrees of freedom. And the two are related. It's just a matter of if you want taking the stem as being the pin. If the slot is wide, I can also rotate about x. In addition to translate about x, I can rotate about z, I can rotate about y. 3-point contact without slip. Here it shows us a sphere with serration, indicative of slip being intended. And this could be the case of a wheel on a surface of the road, where, or maybe a bowl, a billiard, or you know, pool's ball, and it's assumed that there's no relative slip between the ball itself. Well, it could be out of shape. Assume smooth though, where there is a always a common tangent plane and a common normal to the two surfaces in contact. And then we can have slip. So all degrees of freedom allowed less the translation about the z-axis. And as you can see, as shown, they are bilateral joints, so I can separate. By moving up the bowl, I can separate the two. But I can imagine an instance where the joint becomes bilateral by having an offset surface that limits the motion upwards of the bowl. Okay. So you'll see us talking about a helical joint because it's common to power screws. Cylindrical joint, I mentioned the engine, piston engine. We have the piston moving inside of the cylinder, and rather than having a square piston moving in along a square cross section cylinder, we for ease of manufacturing, a cylindrical joint is used instead. But the degree of freedom, rotational degrees of freedom about the axis of the cylinder, it's never employed in practice, only during the assembly stage before the pin is put in place when assembling the engine. So again, ease of manufacturing is the prime reason. The other one is ease of sealing the area between the piston and the cylinder. If it were square, it would be much more difficult, although a little bit of gain in the capacity of the engine by running on square cross section piston and cylinder. So, okay. Alright, so skeleton diagrams, you saw them earlier in the tables provided, you know, type of symbols for a pin joint, for a prismatic joint, 2D view, 3D view. And here's how we represent a crank, power from the ground, possible symbols. This arrow indicates that there's an input, and alternative symbols. Power can come from a cylinder that's fixed to the ground, and we show it this way. And then power can come from a cylinder that is other than connected to the ground, as well as from a joint, pin joint, that is other than connected to the ground. And then these are just passive cranks or rockers, is sometimes called. So you're driven rather than having a motor to be driving links to the ground. Okay, so what is a kinematic chain? Assembles of links connected with kinematic pairs, and there's no base that is specified. It's a higher level of abstraction. By choosing a base, then we can have various application possible, starting with a given kinematic chain. We can obtain alternative mechanisms known as inversions by fixing a ground. This is an area of mechanism known as systematics. So studying in their more general form the links and joints and their assemblages and kinematic chains, which can be open, by the way, or closed. All right. So open chain, two links, one pin joint. It's the area that's called systematics, and we can get various inversion, topological inversions, by assuming different ground links. For example, four bar has only one topological inversion. Would I fix this, or this joint to the ground? I have the same adjacency of joints and links. Again, dimensions, we don't care about them at this stage. This one has just one topological inversion. Would I fix this one on this one? I have the same neighboring. In this, three links, two pin joints. If I fix either this one or the other yellow link, I have the same inversion. If I fix the middle link, I have a second inversion. So two inversions here, one inversion here, one here. See the four links and four joints, one, two, three, and fourth, the sliding joint. So save four links and four joints here. However, I have one of the pin joints replaced with a prismatic joints, and the number of topological inversions here are two this time. So I can fix either a link having its adjacent links connected by pin joints, so either this one or this one, or I can fix one that has one of the links connected by a prismatic joint. So whether what is crosshatch or the block will be a second inversion. These are called Watt and Stevenson kinematic chains. The next complex to the four bar or four link, four joints. Here I have six links and six joints. One, two, three, four, five, six links and seven joints. Sorry. So one, two, three, four, five, six links. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. And likewise here, joints, and number of topological inversions would be either this one and this one, one, and this one, this one, this one, and this one will be a second. So two topological inversions for the Stevenson. Either fix this one and this one, just same inversion, this one and this one, a second inversion, and then this or this, third inversion. So the Stevenson chain has three topological inversions. Again, link lengths do not matter at this stage when discussing topological kinematic inversions. It's where link lengths matter. Symbols for the four bar linkage, symbolization for the slider crank. So R, P, prismatic, R, all rotational joints. And here they are, the topological inversions of the Watt and Stevenson shown We define already planar or 2D mechanisms if any of the links moves out of the plane, or if you have rotations that is other than perpendicular to the main plane, then those are 3D. Although we can consider 2.5 mechanisms, which can be analyzed to a good extent by employing planar kinematic theory. And I give here an example of car jack or excavators and power shovels, loaders. Okay, we discussed piston engines and compressors, where we have a cylindrical joint which would allow for other than 2D motion, but it's not used. And there are some other examples. Again, and we are this book is concerned mainly with the study of planar kinematic chains and 2D mechanisms with revolute or pin joints, prismatic pin and slot, and rolling pairs without or with slip. Helical and any helical pair in power screws will assume it to be a hydraulic or pneumatic actuator as a piston cylinder type for simplicity. So further on, things on mechanism classifications, we distinguish them in 2D as we discuss, or 3D, but there are categories in between. One being the spherical examples here, spherical mechanisms, the axis of rotations, they are intersecting in the same point. This is the cardan or universal joint. This is a indexing mechanism, possibly named spherical Maltese or Geneva wheel, Maltese cross or Geneva wheel. So again, spherical mechanisms. And then 3D mechanisms. This is a foundry manipulator where the operator can, it pivots about the vertical axis, and then you have actuation from the base via these linkages and motors elsewhere. This is a gate closer. This is a it's called a steward platform used in flight simulators and other applications. Further classifications based on the number of loops, single loop or multiple loop mechanisms. So if you're and they derive from closed kinematic chains, okay, so say I have the watt chain, define a base, say this one is the base, this would be a two loop mechanism, as well as the Stevenson. So Stevenson, I fix this link on the second, will be a third loop, but that's not independent of the other two, we sometimes say. Although, and for consistency, we can say that there are three loops present, definitely multiple loop. Four bar, single loop, this one is single loop, this is open chain. Okay. We can have serial or parallel mechanisms in mixed serial parallel. So here we have series of links as well as some motion being, this is fully parallel. So both serial and parallel. Fixing one of the link gets us a simple scare robot I can fix this one. Actually, no, this is just a if I fix one link, I'll just have a crank if I power this joint, okay? But yeah, this is open chain, and there it's a serial corresponding serial robot, and I mentioned scare robot. Well, this would be the most simple form of a scare robot. If we take the compliance motion, the inserting peg type motion. All right, so we can have linkages, we can have cam follow or cam mechanisms, gear mechanisms. Here also being included friction wheel mechanism with flexible links like cable, belts and chains, compliant mechanisms. So compliant being you have links that the form or areas that have increased flexibility to substitute for a pin joint, say. Here's a robot with cables, the chain in use, chain on a bicycle brake. Okay, and then we can have linkage gear mechanism, cam linkage mechanism. So linkage gear mechanisms as a pin in a slot joint with a rack and gear sector. And then further on classification, we can have motion transformers. Takes an input motion and converts that motion into a rotary or so a continuous rotary input, makes it oscillatory input. Think of an oscillating fan, say, or vice versa. Piston motion converted into rotary motion in a steam engine or a piston engine. Compressor motion transformer, you have a continuous rotary input and you move back and forth a piston to compress the air. So these are motion transformers. Function generators. I mentioned at the beginning the steering of an automobile. So here it shows rear wheels, front wheels, the Ackermann or trapezoid linkage, steering linkage. And in order to minimize the amount of slip of the wheels, you want the extension of their axis to intersect the same point and that point to be on the rear axle. Okay. How do you call this? We call it a function generator. There's a actual mathematical relationship that ensures the intersection of the three or rear axle, the front wheel axle, to be on the same at the same point. And it's this equation which involves what the wheelbase, wheel track, and of course I can consider one or the other as the input. Another function generator, it's the linearization mechanism of a barometer or altimeter. So this is a capsule, barometric capsule, thin wall, can with corrugation, and there's reduced pressure inside. As the ambient pressure increases, it deforms inwards, and one side is fixed, the other one moves about rectilinearly, and the linkage part of the amplification mechanism. We have gear amplification, gear sector amplification. So this serves to make it linear, the dependency between the atmospheric pressure and the displacement of the hand against the dial, because you want to have linear scale. It's the easiest to read by men, and also to interpolate between when it's between divisions. As a parameter, the case of a non-linear scale gauge is the fuel gauge. It's not, you cannot tell the amount of gallons of fuels that you have in the tank by just looking at the fuel gauge on the dashboard of most vehicles, or all vehicles that I know. Okay, so function generators could be exact. I can generate exactly a sine motion where phi is the input, displacement u is the output. So this will be a, it's also called, known as Scotch yoke. I can generate exactly the secant function, the tangent function. This could be used to for so these are what? So I have addition here, and here I have multiplication essentially. So U times V equals A over B. All right, more on classification. I have we can have rigid body mechanisms. So we discussed function generators, motion transformer, function generators. So rigid body guidance mechanisms, where you have a body that you want to move through a number of successive positions, either with timing or without timing, that is from the ground for a given angle. I want given displacement. Here would be without timing, wheel suspension mechanism. This also is among motion generator, garage door that is guided using a four bar. And then path generators. Path generators could be the level looping crane here. This is a four bar, this is a couple of point and moves approximately on a straight line. And then the leg mechanism, you know, this will be the path of this point, so it's a path generator. Likewise here, this would be a mixer transport mechanism. And, okay, so we have dwell and intermittent motion mechanisms and controllable motion generators, controllable path generators. Intermittent motion would be the dwell mechanism, as well as Geneva wheels. And oh, interesting, it's in newer versions, if it's an animated GIF, it shows it in motion. That's very interesting. Maybe I should make use of this. Okay, and then the what else? Enveloping, curve enveloping mechanism, you can see it here. Exact path generating, so you can generate an ellipse with this elliptic trammel. It's called, in the past, was your drafting tools with adjustability serving to draw ellipses on paper. This is called a kinetograph of Crawford. And point P, it says, will generate a mathematical curve ellipse, hyperbola, parabola, a conic curve based on the adjustment of links here. Okay, so controllable motion generate, controllable path generators. This could be the case of, so this would be a controllable motion generator. You're handling a, say a melting pot or a large piece that has to be forged. Controlled by a person, although it could be controlled by a computer. So controllable motion generator. controllable path generator, think the pen plotter, or think rapid prototyping machine. All right, in addition, I do have here examples of a couple of curves of a four bar and slider crank. You may be able to use the appearance of one or the other. Say I want to finish an airfoil of a turbine blade, and I can displace, you know, the grinder could be driven by a four bar to finish the surface of the or for other purposes. For example, the two dwell mechanisms here, what they use are a couple curves of a four bar where here is a section that's almost circular, and I'm configuring such that when this point follows this portion of the path, the center of curvature coincides closely with E, and this link is motionless. And same here. However, I need, in this case, a rectilinear portion of the four bar coupler curve, and there's the motion is lost when the coupler point follow, or yes, with the slide to it, follows this portion of the path. All right, so those were dwell mechanisms. Approximate and exact straight line mechanisms. This is the Watt straight line linkage. He employed it in his early steam engines. It's used in a suspension mechanism in train cars, as well as in some rear axle. I think Dodge Durango has a Watt type linkage suspension of the rear axle. Roberts, approximate straight line. And Chebyshev straight line. Hurricane, I think this is also called lambda. And it's an exact straight line path generator called Pulsatile Inverter. So this point here, and you can see some symmetry in the linkage, it follows an exact straight path. Could be used, for example, to guide without the use of any sliding joints. You can guide the cutoff disc of a saw, and because only pin joints are used, it has advantages. Those can be sealed and greased for life versus a sliding joint. If there are contaminants, you need to protect it with bellows, and requires periodic maintenance, cleaning, greasing. Okay, so, and more on basic theory, example of equivalent mechanisms. So there is no apparent crank to this four bar linkage, it's just an eccentric. So I have, this would be the input, this is the center of this large pin, and it works as a short crank. Here, instead of if the slot is circular, it could be other than circular, but if it's circular, then there is an equivalent four bar to it. I can have Scotch yoke, and I can use a pin and a slot and a slider, or I can use a pin and a slot. Output, input, motion. Correlation is the same. Both, as we discussed earlier, can generate exactly the sine or cosine function. This is also four bar, where I have a roller, and I have a roller that as solid with the input link, say this to the left is the input, and if the center of curvature of both curves in contact stay the same, then this will be a former. They may change location if these curves are added in arches or circles or disks. So only momentarily I have a four bar of given dimensions equivalent to the original would be rolling with slip type contact. Here it shows a spring that holds the two in contact. So all three are four bars equivalent under the condition that this is a arch of circle and these two surfaces are circular. Before we move forward to mobility analysis, let's go and look at some animations. I do have here several. So the radial engine. Come on. The radial engine. This is it's called a GNOME engine. It's a rotary engine, so the crank is fixed and the whole engine rotates about the crank. This is another radial engine, but with stationary cylinders. Okay. What else we discussed? Let me go small. And also, where we can see. Okay, so a universal joint. This one uses, as you can see, balls, that is rolling elements. We could model it as a ball joint with a pin. This is the elliptic trammel, ellipsograph, as you can see. So points on the on this link, the floating link, can generate elliptical paths. And this is the conicograph. I think it's configured to Crawford conicograph, configured to generate a parabola. Arbitrarily selected in the plane of the coupler curves. So I have a four bar and all these are points that moves with the coupler. And you can see various shapes. You know, some do have cusps like this one. Some have H shapes. Okay. The dwell mechanisms. Dwell mechanism. Remember a coupler curve that has circular portion, and if I get it to where this is at the center of the curvature, then motion is lost between the four bar and the additional two links, and I have momentarily the over. Or portion of the kinematic cycle, the output link does not move. The other type of dwell, where I have a about rectilinear portion of the coupler curve and motion is lost relative to the, you know, due to the slider relative to the output link. The envelope, elliptical enveloping mechanism. An envelopes and ellipse. You can follow the links to the Wikimedia Commons, another dwell mechanism. Okay, you can see the input-output curve with no motion, so this is almost horizontal. And leg mechanism. this would be a path generator as classification. Have some working models, and always open with working model. So this is the a Geneva wheel with how many 8 spokes. So it does intermittent motion, continuous input, intermittent output. This could be used on in packaging industry or equipment that processes samples. For example, there is a carousel with multiple sample tubes, and it stops to a reactant, drop a reactant that's allowed in each of the tubes as they stop. Or maybe or packaging machine, it stops to place a label. Film camera, the old ones, they use Geneva wheels, motion, picture projection cameras or projectors. All right, modified Geneva. Save. Nope. Okay. Nice path generator if you want. It's a hay baler. It collects hay and moves it in front of the ram. It's describing a patent. 4,825,760. Nope, I don't want to save. Another hay baler. This is a watt to base. So it's a simple one. It's missing parts. So collecting hay and force it in front of the ram. If you look carefully, you recognize here a watt kinematic chain where one of the pin joints has been replaced with a prismatic joint. Okay. I think the earlier one we haven't played the gear 5 bar. So the gear 5 bar, the way they configured is two cranks driven synchronously via a in this case there is a transmission ratio of -1 between the two cranks, and then I have we call this dyad, R dyad, two links in 3 pin joints. Or 3 joints, it's called a dyad. So what else on working model? Four five bar, 6 bar, dwell, cam mechanisms of various types. No, I need to do, remember, edit, select all objects, do not collide. I save it and run. Oh, sorry. And shouldn't have done that. I mean, really, I need to have the software interpret the contact between the roller and the cam. It was something else. I should have just say continue run. So yes. Oh, I saved it already. Okay, can be fixed. So hold the shift key and say objects collide, and hold the shift key, say object collide. Okay, there is an overlap. I think that's where I have to run and say yes. Do you want to continue? Yes. then I'll say world start here. Save it. And now there's no longer that problem. Of course, the cam shapes are smooth shapes generated with this kind of function. The type of motion, though, it's not like the one you'd see in cam follower mechanisms, having the, see, there's not a good accurate dwell for this portion, correspond to this portion of contact between the follower and the cam face or cam surface. There's a conveyor shown as path generator at some point. Okay, so there's parallel motion, and any point moving with this rake type part generate the same type curves. And then I have elliptic trammel, film transport, okay, film transport mechanisms, other than so using the four bar, and it was the coupler curve that was properly selected. Okay, so I can advance film, or maybe other applications, say feeding fabric to some machinery to shear it and cut it to size. Okay, inversions. We discussed earlier about the inversions. So we have the four bar, same four bar, and it's only thing is that it's rotated, and I can have each of the four of the links hold to the ground, and I'll get different behaviors. So, and you can also tell where the motor is. So motor here, motor here, or motor on one of the floating pin joints. We call this crank rocker. The gray link is the input, blue is the output, crank rocker. We call this drag link. So all three moving links perform full rotation. This one in the air, the blue, the coupler in the air, the other two relative to the ground. And then could have the blue link as the input, and I can convert an oscillatory input to continuous rotor input. This is what you would see in maybe pedal actuated sewing machine, like the old ones, or pedal actuated grinders, or lathe machine tools. And this one is, it's called drag link. Double rocker. And if actuated from the ground, here you see it actuated from the one of the floating links, and this is how you see it in oscillating fans. But otherwise, you know, otherwise the limit position would be this one and this one, okay? And here too, you know, I cannot, unless I'm using a flywheel, and the software was tricked to have continuous rotor input by placing the motor on a floating link. But otherwise, you need a flywheel to have continuous motion at the output. Remember the pedal actuated. There's some ride-on toys that use this kind of means of powering the wheels. Inversions of the slider crank. Fixing one or the other to the ground, and I have, these are kinematic inversions, there are four kinematic inversions. Topologic inversions, just two, four kinematic inversions. Four bar in general has four kinematic inversions, just one topological inversion. Okay, so compressor or piston engine, and then this could be a quick return with worth mechanism, depending on, or it could be the just one cylinder, those rotary GNOM engines. And there are some hand pumps, water well pumps, actuated this way. And then there are power takeoff compressors, small compressors. You attach them, power takeoff of a tractor. Okay, we have 10 more minutes, 1 hour and 15 minutes total recording. So let me close this. No. Inversions of the Watt, rather Stevenson, I'm sorry. So fix this one, and then one of these two would be the same. These are topological inversions. Otherwise, kinematic inversions I'll have for an arbitrary Stevenson chain, as many as links. Any symmetry can reduce the number of kinematic inversion. Inversions of the Watt linkage. Again, there are just two. These are topological inversions. Kinematic inversions will be, when no symmetry is present, equal to the number of links. What else? How an iris mechanism looks like. Okay, SawGuard is one of my simulations, so we're going to analyze it for mobility in a new recording, a separate recording on mobility analysis. And then scissor jack. Please note the gear sectors here. This will be the base. This is where the car gets makes contact with the jack, and I have gear sectors. It's essential for those gear sectors to be there. Scotch yoke. Remember exact sine wave between input and output. Velocity and acceleration. Again, sine waves. And I know you hear all these system sounds. Sorry for that. Shaper mechanism. This is a quick return mechanism. So this active stroke, slowly a return happens quicker. This is where time ratio is a parameter of consideration, because it's reflective of the how productive or the productivity of the shaper mechanism. Several straight line linkages now in motion, so run. This is the Watt straight line. This is the Roberts. This is the Chebyshev. This is Hennequin's, also called lambda, and the posterior exact straight line. So these are only approximate straight lines. Clearly this one is. Okay. It all started with this. It was used by James Watt in his early steam engines. Okay. More on Chebyshev straight line. Is one of those the double rocker, but driven from one of the floating joints. Straight line Roberts Watts, straight line Ukraine. Let's see. So have the hook here and can do better than this, then there's no need to have a carriage moving on a boom of the crane. It's just so you have all pin joints. Room at the advantage has easier maintenance. Okay. More on about intermittent motion Geneva mechanisms. Okay. And I guess this will be it. I'm going to stop recording. We'll do another one or a new one on mechanism mobility.